What's up, guys? Welcome back to Let's Play Quake 2. We are nearing the end of this unit, and there's a few things we want to pick up before entering the first technical mini-boss of the game. There's some lasers here that will, if not kill you instantly, at least almost kill you. And we can time them to get that grenade launcher and that jacket armor there, so good stuff. There's also more lasers here that also follow a specific pattern that we can easily predict. And then head up here in this big arena area where we'll fight the first boss, which is simply just called the tank boss for that matter. But there's a few tanks over here that we need to take out before he will reveal himself, and so the typical weapons are going to be used from them, the chain gun and our most powerful newly acquired weapons, the grenade launcher and the hyper blaster. And then the ground is going to shake violently. The game is going to do this quite a bit throughout the rest of the game. There's going to be random sequences, particularly in one level. I'll get to that when it's relevant, where the ground is just going to shake violently, and it's going to be kind of annoying. But say this is more of a mini-boss than an actual boss. Technically, I only really consider this game to have one true, real boss. Because this enemy you basically just deal with as any other tough enemy. And which basically means, you know, trying to hit it from behind with your most powerful weapons. It has quite a few nasty attacks, including a, I believe it has a rapid-fire rocket launcher. Now, one thing you might notice about hitting the Berserkers with the Hyper Blaster, as it happened right there, is that if you hit them in their upper torso section, sometimes you deliver a critical hit, and they'll fall over backwards onto their backs. But they won't be dead yet. They'll actually get up and start attacking you again after a few seconds, so it may be confusing at first, being like, oh, I think I killed it already, and then it just gets right back up again. So that's kind of annoying, especially because they're hard to hit while they're lying on the ground. So we beat the boss, and now we can head down here into the hole that he was covering previously. And that will allow us to exit the unit. Apparently this laser grid has something to do with the security system or something. So we're gonna blow that up, and the security guard has been disabled. Usually I try to have the ending or the beginning of a unit at the beginning of the video. But we're only 2 minutes in, so I figured that that excess part right there wouldn't be too much to tack onto the end of the last video instead of putting it right here. Oh joy, the mines. Probably my least favorite level in the game. Because we were on such a roll there for a little while, and then we just got kind of sidetracked with this crap. But don't worry, we'll be getting a good weapon at least, and we'll be getting back on track for the rest of the game, where the levels will pick up significantly from there as well. Just the mines is probably just my least favorite level in the game. It doesn't have to do with the fact it's bad or anything. I just don't particularly care for it. But because I don't particularly care for it, I really don't have a whole lot to talk about during this part. So I figured I'd go ahead and talk about something that I discovered during my test playing for my Half-Life Decay LP. Because it's kind of interesting, and it does pertain to this game as well, since they're nearly identical with the engine that they use. Well, they use the same engines, just they perform almost identically, gameplay-wise. And, games like this, where you can save at any time, and this was common for PC shooters at the time, and it's still common to this day, you know, the whole quick-save thing. And it was only really common amongst console shooters, rather, that were ported. You know, they had PC versions. You didn't have that kind of feature on console-exclusive shooters. Like, Halo had the whole checkpoint system, which worked really well, don't get me wrong. Let's see if I can get this Hyper Blaster here. There we go. But, the whole being able to save wherever you want thing you had in this game, and in Doom 3, and in the original versions of Doom 1 and 2 that were on the Doom 3 Collector's Edition, and Resurrection of Evil, and Quake 4, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, was just really nice, and you get spoiled on that after a while because, here's the hard part, is getting back over here. No, we didn't take that much damage, and we have that armor. We have that armor! My voice cracking there. Horribly bad. But, there's quite a few little secret areas in this level, but none of them are all that really interesting. I didn't actually notice that message the first time I went through this area. But yeah, I guess you can't get in that way. I didn't even know that was a door, though. Anyway, the whole quick save feature or manual save thing wherever you want to. And like, a lot of games have specific reasons for not doing that because it could be exploited heavily, and it can. But on the contrary, there are things like, with my Decay LP that I'm recording right now, there have been times when I've died, and with Decay, you know, Decay is just a expansion on Half-Life. And obviously in Half-Life you can save wherever you want. You have a temporary save feature even on the PS2 version. And the nice thing about that, as you saw in my, if you watched my original Half-Life walkthrough, which I intend to redo soon enough, saving, you know, quick saving at least was a very essential feature, especially to the success of that walkthrough, because I didn't have to re-record as many levels, because if I died, I would just reload from where the, I would just edit to where the quick save was, and the same thing with this game. But in Decay, when you die, you have to do that whole mission over again, because the chapters are basically set up into small missions, and you have to complete the whole thing in one go. So it's kind of like stages in an old game, like maybe like the old Castlevania games, for instance. When you died, you had to go back to the beginning of the stage. There was no way to save within the stage. And then you got checkpoints within the stages in the same level, and when you got a game over, you had to start from the beginning of the level. It's kind of complicated, but in that game, you died so much, you just had to go through the same thing over and over again. You would think you're doing it so many times that eventually you'd become good at it. But that's not really the case with Castlevania, for instance. It just got infuriating after a while, and you started to get so frustrated that you started losing focus and started losing your touch. Thanks, Grenade Launcher, for blowing up those boxes next to me, by the way. Surprised they actually bothered to put another mutant over here. I'm just having a blast with that Grenade Launcher, by the way. But, yeah, not really a whole lot to say about this area. But getting back to my point, the, there's gonna be, you know, there's tons and tons of data from the Decay recording that is just gonna be completely scrapped because it's a failed attempt. You know, I died, I can't salvage that, because I would just be playing the whole thing again over again. So that would be a whole nother separate chunk of the video, if that makes any sense. So that first part where leading up to where I died is completely useless. And it's just really aggravating, and that's one thing that I'm really not liking about this Decay LP so far, especially because it's such a small game. It's not even really a full game, it's just an expansion within a game. But it'll be a nice demonstration of what Half-Life will look like now with my better recording setup and you know, the HD graphics and everything. So I'm looking forward to it, especially because I like anything that uses the Quake engine. And it's one of my favorite games. Valve games are typically my favorite games, and I have such a respect for Valve and id Software lately that I'm debating, you know, collecting a lot of different versions of some of their games, like even if I already have it, because I have, you know, the PS1 version of Quake 2 in addition to this version, and various other alternate versions of Doom that I'm going to try to find, and maybe the original Xbox version of Half-Life 2, just for the sake of having it. Stuff like that. So I'm becoming a really big fan. Anyway, getting back to the game, there's a gladiator over here, and we haven't seen one of these guys in a little while. But I'm going to try to stay out of his way, because I don't like the idea of his railgun being impossible to dodge, which it is. You just have to hope that he misses you, because it's not really so much you dodging it as much as he misses you. But we should be coming up on that new weapon soon if we don't get annihilated by gunners here and their random grenade spam. Oh, how I love the Hyper Blaster. I guess there's another mutant here, as well as those Icarus guys I showed off in the last video. Those guys are going to be pretty common for the rest of the game, honestly, but they're not really all that tough. I didn't even notice that health over here at first. And Hyper Blaster is really good against them because unlike the machine gun and the chain gun, you don't have the obnoxious recoil of the machine gun, and you don't have the scatter of the chain gun. So Hyper Blaster is probably one of the best weapons for hitting those guys, as well as the sentry guys as well. There's a mega health over there, I think is what that is. But I don't really want to risk getting it because I might fall in and die. Yay for physics and gore. There's a lot of mutants in this area, actually. But that's pretty much going to be the end of it. There's some rockets for a rocket launcher we don't have yet. And I can't go this way yet. I messed up, I think. Yeah. Time for some backtracking. I know there's something that opens that, but I just did the sequence out of order, apparently. That's another thing about this game's surprisingly non-linear levels. Here we go. And save so the gladiator doesn't annihilate me. I don't really have all that much ammo for the Hyper Blaster yet, but this guy is pretty far away, so I actually want to be able to hit him. We're pretty low on health though anyway, so didn't do all that much good. Random pit of death there, I'm not sure what the point of that is. Here's where we get the new weapon, it's the rocket launcher, the ever-anticipated rocket launcher. Now if we try to run through this hallway right here, we're gonna get security laser things from the wall that will shoot out at us, so we kinda have to quickly strafe jump across there and pick it up and get to the other side. I'm looking around for some health because this is not a good situation that I'm in right now, so... Oh well, let's go for it. Alright, we got it, so let's demonstrate it on these gunners over here. And I believe this switch will just shut off the explodey things in the back, in that hallway there that were trying to kill us. Yeah, the rocket launcher is as good as you'd expect it to be in a Quake game. The rocket launcher is that essential weapon you have to have. And you can go without using it in the campaign, but you know, the multiplayer, you gotta have a rocket launcher. As well as a couple other weapons that we'll be getting later. Well, this game technically does not have a lightning gun, as I said. It's just the chain gun is the closest thing to it as far as the multiplayer people are concerned. But yeah, the rocket launcher is pretty good. We don't really have a whole lot of ammo for it right now, despite the fact we've been picking up rockets for it occasionally. We need to grind for some more rockets soon, so we can actually start using this thing on a regular basis. Otherwise, I'll just continue to use the grenade launcher, because it's the other explosive weapon, and we have ammo we don't even know what to do with as far as that thing is concerned. Wow, three gunners in a row. And I ran out of ammo just as I killed the third one. See, like I said, the game is not holding back on those gunners anymore, and it's really annoying. Because they're not any less obnoxious than they were at the beginning of the game. Please don't use a railgun, please don't use a railgun. Ah, he used the railgun. But at least they don't have the shields like they have in Quake 4, so they could always be worse. Now, I believe there's going to be some flyers that'll come around after you push that switch. But I might be thinking of somewhere else in the game. But I believe now that we've taken care of that, now we can go to that area that we were trying to get to before that was closed off. And conveniently, the game gives us the ability to backtrack there without without too much actual backtracking. It gives us a path back there. Including some adrenaline here, so we can just sort of hop down there if we want to. That doesn't exactly look safe to me, though. So I'm going to save. There we go. We didn't get grinded into dust conveniently, but see, the game gives you the opportunity to get back here, but it's not exactly safe. Did I just go back to like the beginning of the level? I may have gone the wrong way again. Okay, here we go. And more of these guys again. Do I have any ammo for the Hyper Blaster? I'm gonna use the rocket launcher. Because the rocket launcher also has projectiles that fly straight. It doesn't ever get that three-shot spamming ability like in Quake 4, but then again, none of the weapons really receive any upgrades. Okay, this is the way I went before. Not the way I need to be going. So I guess that was kind of a unique thing in Quake 4, that they gave the weapons upgradable abilities like that, but it's like, the weapons were as good as they'd ever be in this game, so you didn't need all that crap.